So, please, you can write in Spanish, and I think Alfredo, if you could monitor and pass the questions to me, that would be great.
Okay.
Okay. So, the subtitle is Energy Calculations for Large Molecules, and as you can see here, I'm not a physicist actually. I'm coming from the Department of Chemistry here at SINVESTAF, and this will be influencing a little bit about the story I would like to present in these next couple of hours, which is rather long. So here's an outline what I would like to do. I would like to start with some thoughts on first principle methods. In very general form, this somehow picks up on the talk from Aldo you heard yesterday in the framework of DFT. Then I would like to show you variational density fittings, also first the Coulomb fitting, and then the formulation of auxiliary density functional theory. And after that, I show you some application, in particular the melting of the sodium cluster. Then I go to the development of hybrid functionals inside ADFT and talk a little bit about the performance of these functionals. You have you heard yesterday already that with these hybrid functionals, the performance is an issue. I finish with conclusions and perspectives. So let me start with this picture, which is basically my acknowledgement to the Daemon2k community. As other ab initio software packages, Daemon2k is not the product of one mind, but it's a product of many minds. You see in the top the URL from where you can get information about the software. The software is free. We had until this pandemic every year meeting. This year we don't have that, at least not physically. Here you see a picture of the meeting from 3 or 4 years ago in Canada. It's roughly the same size always, a group of 40 to 50 people. And over the years we have gained here the SINVESTAF group and got fundings from the here mentioned agencies that have helped us to develop this code further on. Here's an outline of the Daemon2k development, which really is a development of density functional theory inside quantum chemistry. And DFT and quantum chemistry at the beginning, so I'm talking about the pre-90s from the last century, had a rather difficult relationship to each other. And I will come to this a little bit later in the talk why this was so. Daemon and also D-Gauss, they were one of the first LCGTO, that means linear combination of Gaussian type orbital, DFT implementations that were used in chemistry. And when you talk about computational simulations in chemistry, different to solid state physics or condensed matter physics, you usually do not assume periodic boundary conditions. In fact, if you think a little bit about chemistry, chemistry is a science at the boundary, and so it's very important to have boundaries. If you have periodic boundary conditions, then boundaries are just gone and your system has an infinite extension. That is just what you don't want to have in chemistry. And that is also a fundamental difference between program implementations in condensed matter physics and in chemistry. Condensed matter physics, you usually use plane waves that have infinite extensions, where in chemistry you use localized basis sets that are localized at an atom and in almost all codes expressed in terms of Gaussian type orbitals. Deimon was originally developed in UDM. This is a picture down here, as a code actually really for the development of DFT in chemistry. It then got a lot of input from the University of Hannover from Germany. And then the first version of the code that is now available was distributed some 15 years ago and has now been distributed to around 450 groups or so. Now let us think a little bit about computational chemistry and electronic structure methodologies in general. Let's take an molecule, what you see here. This is an insulin, and part of the insulin you have in your body. It's a molecule that has around 1,000 atoms. And if you make a rough estimate, you come to something like maybe 10,000 electrons. If you use now an LCAO, a linear combination of atomic orbitals approach, where these electrons are each in one orbital, you come to a point where you have to have 10,000 molecular orbitals inside this expression of the wave function. And at this moment, it is already important to note that this expression of the wave function, which we call a Slater determinant, you also have heard that yesterday, is already a very simplified representation of electronic structure. In Kohn-Sham density functional theory, this is actually the wave function of a non-interacting system, not of the real system, but of the non-interacting system. So this is, if you want to say so, today's standard approach to density functional theory.
Excuse me, Professor, your screen is not shared.
The screen is not shared?
No.
You cannot see the screen?
Not yet.
Okay.
Just for a moment, it won't.
Oh, it disappeared. Okay, don't know why this happened. Now it's back?
Yes.
Okay. Let me go. Sorry for that. So we were at this point here of the Slater determinant. So this is a standard approach to DFT. So this is basically used homologous if you say Kohn-Sham DFT or DFT. On the other hand, there is a version of DFT that is called orbital-free density functional theory. This is, if you want to say so, the exact formulation of the Thomas Fermi model. This orbital free DFT is driven by the density, and these 10,000 molecular orbitals, which if every orbital is located in Euclidean space, make 30,000 degrees of freedom, is reduced to 3 degrees of freedom. So that is basically one of the fundamental promises of density functional theory, not of Kohn-Sham density functional theory, but of density functional theory, that in principle, you can drive quantum mechanical calculations instead of the wave function, which appears in the Schrödinger equation, by directly the density, and this gives an enormous simplification of the degrees of freedom in the system. So when we started many, many years ago to develop density functional methods for quantum chemistry, one of our fundamental questions was, is there nothing in between? Is there only Kohn-Sham on one side an orbital-free density functional theory on the other side. So when you look from this viewpoint to density functional theory, then a good starting point is, of course, the Cohn-Sharm energy, which I show you here in the top, which is given by three terms. The first term represents what we call the core energy, which is basically the energy that one electron has in the framework of the nuclear body. The second term, with the one half in front, is the electrostatic repulsion between the electrons in the system. And the third term, which is the exchange correlation energy, is the representation of all the non-classical energies of the electrons in the system. And this energy expression here is one of the reasons why quantum chemists had for a long time really a hard feeling, so to speak, towards density functional theory. Because if you think about this exchange correlation energy, as we have heard yesterday, is in an exact form unknown and must be approximated by some kind of density function. The current exchange correlation functionals, almost all, come up from very crude estimates, which are estimates towards or based on the homogeneous electron gas. So even the exchange energy that is inside these exchange correlation functional is an approximation. And quantum chemists know since ever that Hartree-Fock has, so to speak, an exact exchange energy inside. And this is actually a very important point, because the exchange energy is not only reflecting the exchange of the electrons, but it also corrects for a failure in the calculation of this Coulomb repulsion, because if you write it down in this form, where you know that this is the density of electron 1, this is a 1 over R12 operator, and this is the density of electron 2, you are basically having self-interactions. These self-interactions is exactly cancelled in Hartree-Fock by the Fock exchange term, but it never ever can be exactly cancelled by an approximated exchange energy that is calculated for the homogeneous electron gas in terms of plane waves if you use for the expansion of this density atomic orbitals centered at nuclei. So it seems that the Cohn-Sharm energy expression is fundamentally ill compared to Hartree-Fock. Surprisingly, if you look at results, the Cohn-Sharm energy expression provides much better molecular structures, molecular structure parameters, optimized binding energies, and so on, as Hartree-Fock does. And the reason for that is this inclusion of correlation that compensates for a complete lack of correlation inside Hartree-Fock, and therefore brings Cohn-Sharm energy expressions onto a post-Hartree-Fock level of accuracy. So if you look at this energy expression, then you can immediately see, if you use LCAO, this red underlined term of the Coulomb repulsion between the electrons is the computational most time-demanding part. And you can then use auxiliary density methods where you substitute this product representation of the density by an approximate representation, which is, however, linear. You can do this in terms of a variational fitting. In this part, it is called the variational Coulomb fitting. And what you see is that you are here defining an error, a quadratic error, between the exact Cohn-Sham density and your approximated density. You now can expand both of these quantities in terms of atomic orbitals and in terms of rho tilde auxiliary functions. These here are the expansions in terms of atomic orbitals. These are the mu and nus. And in terms of auxiliary functions, these are these k bar. And you can come up with an expression of this form that is intrinsically positive definite. That is very important for the further discussion here, because it now allows us to formulate this Coulomb energy in equality. With this part here on the left-hand side represents the Coulomb energy calculated in LCAO, where you see here the four center electron repulsion integrals, which introduces the formal n to the fourth scaling of the methodology. So if you implement Cohn-Sham in LCAO, you have an n to the fourth scaling, where n is the number of your basis functions. And you see that you can now relate this to the right-hand side expression, where you no longer have four center terms, but you have only three center terms as given by this three center electron repulsion integral. So you formally reduce the scaling of the methodology by one order of magnitude. And it is important at this point here to note that this development was long time neglected in quantum chemical Cohn-Sham implementation, because it was based basically on a modification on Hartree-Fock codes, where this kind of approximation of the Coulomb part has no meaning, because you have a similar part for the Fock exchange that is not approximately, or that cannot be approximated in this form as it is shown here for the Coulomb fitting. So the people who developed Gaussian and WChem games and so on, they said, yeah, it's unfortunately for us not really a good fitting, because we also have the Fock exchange. Even so, this is not really true if you would use an LDA, GGA, or meta-GGA functional in the LCAO framework. So over the years, I would say now since at least 20 years or so, this kind of approximation has become a standard also in quantum chemistry. Now, in order to find the new variational coefficients, these are these xk. So you have now two sets of coefficients. You have coefficients which are the MO coefficients that are inside these density matrix elements, and you have fitting coefficients which are these xk's. The MO coefficients are normally propagated during the self-consistent field iterations, but the fitting coefficients are at this moment unknown. For the fitting coefficients, to obtain the fitting coefficients, we minimize the second order fitting error that results in this part of linear equation system that we can cast in linear algebra form in order to solve it. And then you can calculate these fitting coefficients. So that means, however, that you now have to calculate in each SCF step two sets of variables. One set are the MO coefficients and the other set are the fitting coefficients. And you can do this in a scheme that is outlined here. If you do the energy variation with respect to the MO coefficients and you introduce the orthonormality condition for the molecular orbitals, you obtain an analog to the Rotan-Hall equations, which are called the Cohn-Sham equations. And this solution of these generalized eigenvalue equation system represents a minimization of the SCF energy. On the other side, if you vary these energy expression with respect to the fitting coefficients, as I have shown you before, you find the minimization of the fitting error, but this minimization of the fitting error is at the same time a maximization of the SCF energy. So in fact, if you do this approach where you use the variational fitting of the Coulomb potential inside your Cohn-Sham energy expression, you can write this then down in such a resolution of the identity energy expression, what you obtain is an min-max SCF, where with the variation of the MO coefficients, you minimize the energy along these isolines here, and with the maximization of the SCF energy with respect to the fitting coefficient, which is equivalent to a minimization of the fitting error, you maximize the SCF energy inside or along this isoline. And the convergence point is just this settled point here on the surface. This looks at first instance and rather complication of the SCF procedure, which I have described here stepwise. So we start in the SCF procedure with the construction of the Cohn-Sham matrix elements. Then we are minimizing the SCF energy by the solution of the generalized eigenvalue equation for the Cohn-Sham equation systems. That is analog to Rotan-Hall. This gives us a new density matrix. And with this new density matrix, we now can calculate the lower SCF energy. This is the energy down of the converged SCF energy. Then with this new density matrix, we can calculate a new set of Coulomb vector elements. We can now solve the fitting equation system, which is a maximization of the SCF energy, and we get an upper SCF energy. And so if you yesterday have participated in the Demon 2K hand-on sessions, you have seen the SCF, and in the SCF, you always saw a lower and an upper energy printed out. These are these two energies, which I show you here. And the SCF have to bring these two energies together in form of such a difference. These epsilon SCF, which you see here, this is then the SCF error that you converge in such an energy optimization at a given geometry of your system. If the convergence is not reached, you go to the next SCF cycle. If it is converged, you go out of the SCF. So what is the difference to standard SCF methodologies where you don't use the variational Coulomb fitting, in standard SCF methodologies, you only calculate one SCF energy. In fact, this is the SCF energy you are calculating, this upper SCF energy, and you minimize this upper SCF energy until you are satisfied with your threshold. If you have only one SCF energy in an SCF cycle, you do not know how far you are really away from the convergence point. However, in this SCF, because you have a lower and an upper SCF energy, you have this difference, you have a measurement how far you are away from this convergence point. And this measurement can be used to drive the SCF. And that is an enormous simplification of SCF convergence procedures. Okay, are there questions or comments at this point? Everything understood? Are you still alive?
Yes, we are here.
Okay, no questions, no comments at this point? Hi?
You need to raise your hand to make these questions.
Let me change this here a little bit so that I can see the chat maybe. Can you, is this point?
Can you turn on your?
I asked, sorry. Is until this point, do we have some questions or some comments?
Marcelo is raising hand.
Okay, I don't see yes, the hello. Raising hand. Please go ahead.
Okay, thanks. First of all, I think that the chat is not working, but I will try to make my question.
Okay.
So this Coulomb fitting is just to know if we are close or not to the SCF convergence, right?
Exactly. This is a result of the Coulomb fitting if you reformulate the SCF in the form as I have shown you. We call this the min-max SCF.
Okay, so the energy that we obtain after the Coulomb fitting, that doesn't have any physical sense because no. I think that the good energy is the lower one, right?
Yeah, the good energy is the energy you obtain after SCF convergence. The energies during the SCF convergence, in fact, don't have any sense. They actually can go up and they can go down because if you interchange, for example, the occupation of the molecular orbitals, you are doing a simple relaxation, there is no guarantee that this goes always down. This is not a quadratic optimization procedure. It's a simple relaxation procedure. But the information you have by the min-max SCF is that you have two borders. And if these borders are far away from each other, you know that you are far away from a convergence point. And if these two energy borders are close together, you know that you are close to a convergence point. So we are using these borders, for example, to switch on things like DIIS, which are accelerations of the SCF convergence. They can go completely wrong if the error is very large. But if the error is very small, these kind of accelerators give you a fast SCF convergence. We are also using this, for example, if we do something like dynamical level shift. If you have transition metal clusters, you have a huge density of states at the Homolumo gap. And you somehow need to separate these density of states during the SCF convergence. And for this, we are artificially split the occupied and unoccupied manifold of the orbitals. And this splitting is triggered, how large we make this splitting, for example, by this energy separation we are calculating inside this min-max SCF.
Okay, thanks.
Okay. Some other questions?
We got another question from Daniel Robledo.
Okay, adelante.
Hey, hello. I have a question. You optimize the energy. Can you use any algorithm for optimization? It's important. What kind algorithm do you use? I don't know.
Yeah, for the, as I told you, for the SCF energy optimization, the standard algorithm that is used in many programs is simple relaxation. It's good. Simple iterative relaxation method. However, when you come closer to SCF convergence, you can use subspace-based methodologies, also Krylov-based methodologies. One of them is called DIIS, and it is very popular in quantum chemistry. The only trick here is you cannot switch this on too early, because then your subspaces are really bad and you never converge. So you need to have a control, you need to have an information of how close you are to the SCF convergence point. And that is what I try to point out, that this information, the min-max SCF, can give you.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Do we have some other questions? No? Okay.
Professor, I got one.
Yeah, okay. Adelante.
I think that you can make a picture of these two center integrals.
Yeah.
So what is the picture for that kind of integrals?
Well, the two center integrals is that you have two density distributions that are from two different electrons. And one of these density distribution now creates an electrostatic potential that acts on the density distribution of this other electron. So you have one electron produces a potential and the other electron produces a density. And then you have a simple integral rho times potential. That is a Coulombic repulsion between the electrons. Now, having said this, the picture is not so simple if you come to Fock exchange. So what is Fock exchange really? Well, it's not really clear. There is not a unique picture for Fock exchange, but the usual picture we are taking is that Fock exchange exchanges an electron from here to the position of an other electron from there. So you have such an exchange of two electrons. And this gives you, this exchange of electrons gives you a stabilizing energy. That is the Fock exchange energy. It is a stabilizing part. So if you quantum mechanically describe two electrons and these electrons are closer together, then the repulsion between these two electrons is less than you would expect from classical mechanics. And this reduction in repulsion is to first instance due to the Fock exchange. It's not 100% correct because you also have a correlation contribution, but the correlation contribution is usually 10 times smaller than the Fock exchange contribution. And this quantum mechanically Fock exchange contribution is in the order of chemical bonding energies. This is why it is so important to describe it correctly. Does this answer your question?
Yes, thank you.
Okay, then let us continue with the presentation. Okay. Do you see my slides?
Yes.
Okay, good. This is all what we had already. We did the SCF. Okay, this is here how you can drive the SCF with the auxiliary density. You can, instead of using density matrices or MO coefficients, which are quadratic scaling quantity, you can use the fitting coefficient vector, which is a linear scaling quantity, to drive SCF convergence. And the driving goes in such a way that along these isolines here, that along these isolines here, you always do minimizations. You always search the minimum, but that the maximization, this is the minimization with respect to the MO coefficient, so with respect to the quadratic quantity, but that the maximization here along this isoline, which is a variation with respect to the fitting coefficients, you are altering. Instead of, for example, going here really to the maximum, you are going only to a part up here, and this then can generate you a faster convergence to your settle convergence point. So this makes it possible to use SCF acceleration techniques for very large systems. So yesterday we have heard that the limit of Cohn-Sharm DFT calculations might be in the range of 1,000 atoms. I show you that this is by far not the limit. You can go to much larger systems with several thousand atoms. So, but before we go here, we are now looking what has happened with our energy expression when we introduce the variational fitting of the Coulomb potential. So this part, which was originally our computational bottleneck, has now been interchanged by these two types of integrals. One is three center, the other one is two center. And if you analyze now this energy expression, which is the energy expression from the variational Coulomb fitting, or also often called resolution of the identity DFT or Dunlap fitting, then you see that the most time-consuming computational task is now the calculation of these exchange correlation energy functionals. And this brings us now naturally to auxiliary density functional theory, where we substitute everything here is the same as before, only that I have explored LCAO expansion, where we now substitute inside the exchange correlation energy functional the density by its approximate analog. This is the approximate density I obtain from the Coulomb fitting. If you remember, in this fitting, I'm fitting densities. So I obtain this approximate density that is a linear scaling quantity. So if I now look, can I make variations of this energy expression with respect to the density matrix elements? That would be an indicator that this energy expression is variational. I have no problems here in the front. Okay, varying, the P disappears, varying, the P disappears. This term has no contribution whatsoever. But the question is, what is the variation of this exchange correlation energy functional now, however, evaluated with the approximated density? And that term here is, at least at first instance, unknown. To calculate this term, I follow standard functional algebra. I make a mixed chain rule, where I have here a variational derivation of the exchange correlation functional with respect to this approximated density. If I would do Cohn-Sharm, simply you would put away the tildes of this density. Now, but here there is an important issue. In Cohn-Sharm, this variation defines me an exchange correlation potential. And I mean define. It's really a definition. Here, now, I have a different variation. And I must define a new exchange correlation potential. Now, an exchange correlation potential that is a functional of the approximated density and not of the Cohn-Sharm density. And then I have here this partial derivative of the approximated density with respect to these density matrix elements. And these partial derivatives can straightforward be algebraically evaluated. If I put all of this together, I now see that I indeed can formulate such kind of variation of these exchange correlation energy functional of the approximated density with respect to the density matrices. I obtain this kind of expression where I have here an exchange correlation potential defined as functional of the approximated density. From a computational point of view, now I have simplified my numerical integration to this term, which is a completely linear scaling term on the grid. And now I can write my Cohn-Sharm matrix elements in this very simple form, where I've introduced here the Coulomb fitting coefficients and here these Zk, which I call the exchange correlation fitting coefficients defined by this expression here from the previous kind of derivation of the exchange correlation functional. What you see here is that the Cohn-Sharm matrix elements depend only on fit coefficients. These fit coefficients are linear quantities different to the MO coefficients or the density matrix elements or the density matrix in general. And this simplifies greatly the calculation of the Cohn-Sharm matrix elements, particularly in parallel. So one of these advantages is that ADFT is relatively easily, I apologize already now for all the people who are involved in this parallelization, but it is relatively easily to parallelize. So you can use massive parallel architectures for these kind of calculations with hundreds and hundreds of cores, and you still obtain very good scalings. That is one fundamental advantage. You see here some other key points you can read by yourself. I don't want to discuss in detail. I want to go now a little bit to the performance of ADFT as it was implemented originally some more than 10 years ago. You see already here in these slides CPU time versus system size. Down here, this is the number of orbitals in the system. And you see here the scaling for the construction of the Cohn-Sharm matrix that reaches here in linear form. This was a publication some really 15 years ago. And already at that time, we saw the diagonalization of the Cohn-Sharm matrix, which is a cubic scaling process, is a rather large part compared to the other tasks in the calculation there. Here's now something a little bit more modern, a publication for this year, where you see SCF calculations on giant fullerenes. The largest fullerene here still has 960 atoms, so this is in the range of the 1,000 atoms that have been mentioned yesterday. This system here has something like 90,000 auxiliary functions. And these calculations can be done on moderate architectures, also single point energy calculations, can be done with, let's say, something like 16 or 32 cores in a few hours of computational time. I want to show you something else. This is a system we are just now calculating. This is the enemy we are facing in the moment. This is the COVID-19 protease, and we are doing here structure optimizations of these protease, starting from a crystal structure obtained by some people in China. This system has around 5,000 atoms. And we are not calculating only the energy of this system, but we are doing the structure optimization of the system. So each point you see here in the above graph is one complete energy and gradient calculations. So such energy and gradient calculations with the admissible crude method we are using here takes roughly in the moment 12 hours on 196 cores. So this is to the performance of ADFT where we can go. And you saw already, this is a performance that can go to thousands of atoms in these calculations. These, of course, are then demanding calculations, and they need a lot of cores, as more usually as better. Now, I would like to switch gear at this point and going away a little bit from the computational performance of ADFT to the accuracy of ADFT, because up to now, I have introduced this as an approximation to the Cohn-Sham methodology. And if you see this here, this table, these are relative energies of structure-optimized C80 fullerenes. And what you see here in these columns are the relative energies of these fullerenes. You see this D5D here is the minimum in kilocalories per mole with respect to this minimum structure. And in this column here, the ADFT column, you now see the relative energies that are calculated with ADFT. And if you compare these energies, you see that the differences are in the range of maybe a tenth of a kilocalorie per mole. So at least from here, you can conclude, obviously, ADFT is a good approximation to Cohn-Sham. If you look at the computational time, these calculations are roughly 10 times faster than this one. But then you look at the total energies and you see something rather disturbing. The difference in the total energy between the Cohn-Sham formalism and the ADFT formalism is large. It's in the range of 10 kilocalories per mole. It is 100 times larger than the difference in the relative energy. How can this be? How can ADFT be a good approximation to Cohn-Sham when the total energies are so much different? To address these problem, I would like here to collect some observations we have found over the last, I would say, 10 years working with ADFT as an approximation to Cohn-Sharm methodologies. Well, what you obviously saw from these relative energies, the calculation, at least in relative terms, of the exchange correlation energy and of the Coulomb potential must be rather good using this auxiliary density here. Because only with this, you are getting at least systematically meaningful total energies. Also by themselves, the individual energy might be quite different from Cohn-Sharm. They are systematically different. Now, an obvious approach to think about this convergence between ADFT and Cohn-Sharm would be to say, okay, I make my Rotilde better and better and better so that the Rotilde at the end of the day becomes rho. Of course, if Rotilde is rho, then ADFT is Cohn-Sharm. There's nothing to discuss about. But if you actually look at the used approximated densities in these calculations, for example, for the C80, you see that in a topological analysis, this rho tilde is very, really very different from the Cohn-Sharm density. So the convergence over the approximated density becoming the Cohn-Sharm density is obviously not the reason why ADFT works. This you can also see if you calculate dipole moments. So if you calculate molecular dipole moments, we will discuss this in more detail on Thursday, you can calculate them in this form where you have these density metrics, and these dipole moments you calculate here with ADFT are identical to the Cohn-Sharm dipole moments. And again, you can interpret this as a calculation over Cohn-Sharm orbitals, which are now functionals from the approximated density. So this works obviously very well. On the other side, if you use the approximated density directly for the dipole moment calculation, that doesn't work. So obviously, it's not the convergence of the approximated density towards the Cohn-Sharm density, which makes ADFT, auxiliary density functional theory, working. You can go to perturbation theory and basically you can obtain the same insight also from there. So the question is, what makes auxiliary density functional theory working? And the point here is that we really have to go back to the very fundamentals of DFT, namely to the Hohenberg-Cohn theorem. So if I use the Hohenberg-Cohn theorem in terms of a mapping theorem, as it was done yesterday, then this theorem makes me a unique mapping from the density to the external potential of the system. That is basically the first Hohenberg-Cohn theorem proof. Of course, this mapping is in both sides, but I'm only interested actually in the mapping from the density to this external potential. So, the mapping, however, is not only to the external potential. The mapping is also, that is more trivial, to the number of electrons in the system. That is easy because you simply integrate this density and you obtain the number of the electrons in the system. So you have a unique mapping from the density to the external potential and to the number of electrons in the system. And then you can make a homework and you can write down a non-relativistic molecular Hamilton operator let's say, for the helium atom. And you will see that when you write down this Hamilton operator for the helium atom, this Hamilton operator only depends on this external potential. In the case of the helium atom, this is the nucleus and the number of the electrons, the two electrons in the system. So then, if you have the Hamilton operator in this sort experiment, you can solve Schrödinger's equation uniquely. You never solve in real, but in your sort experiment. And then you have a unique mapping from the Hamilton operator to the energy. And from this, Kohn concluded that the energy must be a unique functional of the density. I would really like to reflect on this conclusion for one moment more, because it is also deep in quantum mechanics. If you think about the Schrödinger equation defined here by the Hamilton operator, what is really physical in the Schrödinger equation? The Hamilton operator is a mathematical operator. The wave function is a mathematical construct that has no observable analog. And the only, but only physical meaningful quantity in the Schrödinger equation is at the end the energy. Yeah? And this Schrödinger equation has opened up the door to theoretical physics and theoretical chemistry, doing in a way that you work excessively with abstract quantities. The Hohenberg-Kohn theorem and the Hohenberg-Kohn formalism brings you back to something that is very elementary, that says a physical observable, the energy, is a functional of another physical observable, the density. So it also has really an impact in basic quantum mechanics. Okay, so this is the Hohenberg-Kohn theorem in terms of mapping relations. Now let us see what does the variational fitting of the Coulomb potential do in mapping. It maps the Kohn-Sham density uniquely by solving an inhomogeneous equation system to this approximated density. Now we can include this condition, even so we don't do this in practical calculations, but we could do this. And then we have here again a density. Now it is an approximated density, but the Hohenberg-Kohn theorem in fact does not care what is this for a density if it fulfills the fundamental properties of a density. And if rho tilde fulfills these fundamental properties, and we take care actually in the calculation that it does it, then we can build a Hohenberg-Kohn analog for the approximated density. And the only difference to the original formulation is that we now have here an approximated energy functional, which is now an energy functional of the approximated density. So if we combine now this mapping and this mapping, we come to this equation, which now maps me the Kohn-Sham density on this new energy functional from the approximated density. And by closure, we then can have this relation where we have the original mapping of the Kohn-Sham density on the energy functional of the Kohn-Sham density, and in between we have this part here, which is the intrinsic approximation used in ADFT. So the approximation is not the use of the approximated density in energy functionals, but the approximation is that we equalize this unknown universal energy functional by another unknown universal energy functional. So we equalize something unknown by something other unknown. That is the true approximation behind ADFT. Now, this sounds a little bit super strange in this moment, but if we bring it back to Earth, it means nothing else that if we have a given exchange correlation energy functional in a Cohn-Sham framework, which originally was derived for the Cohn-Sham density, we use the exactly same functional expression in ADFT. That is the fundamental approximation ADFT makes. And this now also explains us why relative energies are so equal compared to Cohn-Sham, but absolute energies are so much different. In any Cohn-Sham calculation, you are introducing a new artificial energy bound. And this new artificial energy bound in your Cohn-Sham calculation is defined by the exchange correlation functional you are using. And remember that this bound can be below the exact energy of the system. There is no variational principle in the quantum chemical sense in Cohn-Sham theory. That is important to realize. So if you use now instead of Cohn-Sham ADFT, you are moving this energy bound. And as a result, the total energies are rather different. But you are moving this total energy bound in a systematic way for any system you are calculating. And if you now look at relative energies, which are the differences of the total energies, then these relative energies inside a Cohn-Sham calculation and inside an ADFT calculation are very, very similar, with similarities in the range of a tenth of a kilocalorie per mole. So, again, I would like to break here for a moment, and I would like to ask questions, comments. This is really heavy stuff, and it is absolutely understandable that there are problems with it. So please, this is the opportunity to shoot. I don't see you. Alfredo, can you manage the questions? Hello?
I think Alvaro has one question.
Ah, yes.
Go ahead. Yeah, your question.
Thank you. Thank you. Good morning. First of all, I only bring a little question about not everything that is showing here is without any relativistic correction. So if there is a huge error if we don't use relativistic correction, or is it strictly necessary to in the end use it to real world calculations?
Okay, Alvaro, the first question I have is, if you think about the Cohn-Sham theorem, is the Cohn-Sham theorem derived with a relativistic Hamiltonian or with a non-relativistic Hamiltonian?
Non-relativistic.
Exactly. So that is very important to mention here. The whole Cohn-Sham formalism is derived and theoretically founded in a non-relativistic framework. And you can easily see this if you make relativistic extensions to Cohn-Sham, you come into very ugly problems very soon. That is why most relativistic corrections to Cohn-Sham are done on a phenomenological basis.
Okay.
That is one point that is very important to realize. For example, I mean, take NMR response. You don't have a first order perturbation response to an external magnetic field. So the response is completely imaginary if you use really an Kohn-Sham functional. And you would have to use something like an hybrid functional to see such kind of response. Yeah. So that is from the formal point of view, we are on a very formalistic point of view here. We are strictly non-relativistic. And we are strictly non-relativistic because we are following the path of Kohn, of Levy, and so on. From a practical point of view, it's actually no problem. Scalar relativistic, you can introduce either by effective core potentials, model core potentials, then you go in the direction of pseudo potentials, or you can introduce it by something like SORA, zero order regular approximation. And that has been shown in the literature since 20 years that works rock solid.
Excellent. Okay.
The problem comes a little bit if you go beyond scalar relativistic correction. So if you want to have, for example, spin orbit couplings, also in quantum mechanics, it's ya no longer really clear what is the formulation of the Hamiltonian. And you have exactly the same kind of problem in Kohn-Sham or in auxiliary density functional theory. Does this answer your question?
Yes.
Okay.
And I have another, maybe more basic question.
Sure.
I cannot finish to grasp the concept of exchange energy between it and the electrons. It's considered a physical interchange of the electrons, or is just energy transfer, or what kind of phenomenon is?
That is a very difficult question, I must admit. I have not understood this so far by myself completely. If you write the exchange energy in form of the off-diagonal elements of the first-order density matrix, rho from R1, R1 prime, then the question is, what is the R1 and R1 prime meaning?
Yes.
You have one particle, but you have two coordinate vectors. So if you put this in the context of quantum mechanics, which is really the strangest thing I ever have seen in my life, then you have the situation that one and the same particle can be accessed by two vectors, by two position vectors, by R1 and R1 prime. And the reason for that simply is the particle is extended. So you can now interpret these coordinate vectors as the positions where electron one appears and electron one disappears.
Okay, like it's a transition.
It's not a transition, it's an appearance, a creation, and annihilation.
Okay,
we are trying to pictorial figure creation and annihilation operators. So you have a creation of electron one at R1, and you have an annihilation of electron one at R1 prime. And at the same time, you have a creation of another electron at R1 prime and an annihilation at R1. So the total density doesn't change, because the total density doesn't look at individual electrons. It looks at electrons in an average.
Okay.
But the correlation between two electrons is changing. And that can be easily interpreted by such kind of exchange the position of the electrons in space. The point is also that if you look at the physical, I mean, way how exchange acts, if the two electrons are far away from each other, you don't have exchange. The exchange goes actually proportional with the overlap of the wave functions for these electrons. That is completely different to Coulomb. Right? If electrons are far away, you still have Coulomb repulsion.
Yeah.
But you don't have exchange. And only if the electrons come closer together, you see these electronic exchange effect. That means if you look at the Coulombic energy, asymptotically, it is classically. And if the electrons come closer together, the repulsion energy is diminished compared to the classical counterpart.
Something like tunneling like? Or
say it again, please.
Like something similar like tunneling or something like that?
No, it's not a tunneling effect.
Yeah.
Actually, I mean, it has an own name. It's called Fermi exchange.
Okay.
Yeah, because on the Fermi surface, you have this. And one of the reasons why Hartree-Fock is so bad is it calculates this effect between electrons that have the same spin exactly, very accurately. But this effect also is there between electrons that have different spins. We don't call it exchange. Now, don't get confused. That is not exchange. We call it correlation. But the effect, the fundamental physical effect, is very similar. It also disappears for large distances. And this effect in Hartree-Fock is completely neglected. And this makes Hartree-Fock such an unbalanced description.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Are there other questions and comments? So everybody has understood everything? That is a real surprise. That's the best result I ever had in my presentation so far. How do you feel? We continue?
Yes, please.
Okay.
Please go ahead with your presentation.
Okay. So then I put on the presentation again. Don't know why this always. Do you see the presentation?
Yes.
Okay. So we went through a lot of slides already. Okay, so here we were. So what we have is we have an Hohenberg-Kohn serum analog for ADFT, and this is why we have named it some maybe 5 years ago or 10 years ago, auxiliary density functional theory. So ADFT is indeed another DFT methodology that is an alternative to Kohn-Sharm density functional theory. It's not an approximation of Kohn-Sharm DFT. And this is now outlined here in this picture. So if you do standard Kohn-Sharm theory, what you are doing is you have a real system. Yeah. Let's say our helium atom that looks so with an external potential that is Coulombic. And then, however, your Kohn-Sharm calculation is not in this system. Your Kohn-Sharm calculation is in this system, which has another external potential, which looks very different from this Coulombic potential of your real system. But this here is the external potential of the non-interacting Kohn-Sharm system. So here you can fill it in electrons without that they see each other. If you fill in electrons here, you always have this nasty electron-electron interaction. which makes the calculation so complicated. And this external potential is created in such a way that the density in this system here, which we call the Cohn-Sham density, equals the density in this system here. And this density is the Cohn-Sham density. In LCAO, it is this quadratic quantity. Now, if we do ADFT, we have a very similar picture, only that we now connect these two systems not by the Cohn-Sham density, but we connect these two systems by this rho tilde, by what we call the auxiliary density. And the advantage is obvious. If we look back, here this density is a quadratic quantity, and here this auxiliary density is a linear quantity. This greatly simplifies the whole computational procedure behind these calculations. And then, of course, also your Cohn-Sham potential, which you have here. So this potential becomes a functional of rho tilde, and everything else becomes a functional of rho tilde. So your Cohn-Sham orbitals become functionals of rho tilde. So if we are at this point, this is now down here, then we have resolved the computational bottlenecks for the Coulomb repulsion calculations, which have reduced our formal scaling from n to the 4 to n to the 3rd. And now we also have resolved the computational bottleneck for the calculation of these exchange correlation functional. And clearly, of course, always a bottleneck remains. Now we have a much weaker bottleneck, which is built by this term here, which includes three center electron repulsion integrals. And for this, we developed a couple of years ago what is called double asymptotic expansions. It's basically that we can transform asymptotically these quantum mechanical electron repulsion integrals in kind of expressions that look almost like classical molecular mechanics expressions. So with this double asymptotic expansion, we have a mathematically exact bridge from quantum mechanics into molecular mechanics, at least in principle. We don't use it in this form. In the moment, we use it in the form of simplifying our calculations. And if you now look at timings, which are given here, the most important point are these 1% here. This is the timing for the calculation of the electron repulsion integrals and for the calculation of the exchange potential. This here is for alkane chains, one-dimensional systems. This here is for graphene sheets, so systems like this, two-dimensional systems. And this here is for diamond-type systems, so three-dimensional systems. And you see here now, because the systems are not so large, these kind of calculations for the electron repulsion integrals and the exchange potential take over larger fractions. But in general, if you think about that they are in standard LCAO Cohn-Sham methodologies, the time demand, most time demanding computational bottlenecks, you see that they have basically disappeared, and that ADFT, at least in this implementation, let's say 5 years ago, was no longer bounded by computational performance, but it simply was bound by RAM size. Because of course you still have to carry the Cohn-Sham matrix, you have to carry transformation matrices, and these demand RAM allocation. And in the last 5 years or so, we were mainly fighting with this RAM allocation, not so much with the performance computationally of the method itself. So let me show you now an example what one can do with such a methodology at an ab initio level of theory. And I would like to discuss with you briefly the melting of sodium clusters as an application. And you have seen this picture also in maybe a different form last yesterday. What you see here is a hierarchy of different methodologies. So down here you have first principle electronic structure methodologies. The typical length scales for these calculations are in the range of angstroms, and the typical time scales is in the range of femtoseconds to a few picoseconds. Then you have here semi-empirical methods or also DFTB methods. These methods still are electronic structure methods. So they do describe electrons like first principle methods, but in an approximated way. In particular, they approximate brutally, one has to say to some extent, the Hamilton operator. And then you come to molecular mechanics, which is a complete classical approach. In this methodology, you no longer have something like electrons. So if you look at this, then what ADFT is doing, it enlarges for first principle methodologies the length scales into the nanometer region, so in a similar size region, which is typical for semi-empirical methods, and it enlarges the time scale, and this is what we will look now for molecular dynamics. These are, in this particular case, Born-Oppenheimer molecular dynamics to nanoseconds. So these are 1 million femtoseconds. And of course, one of the aims we have is that we can do nanosecond molecular dynamic simulations for system sizes with 1,000 atoms. We are not at this point yet. We can do these simulations for system sizes, which let's say 150 to 200 atoms. That is possible with the current implementation. So this here shows you a Born-Oppenheimer molecular dynamics description using ADFT with linear combination of Gaussian type orbitals. It's free of four center areas. It's linear scaling in the exchange correlation part, and so on and so on and so on. And this is the experiment we were motivated by. It is now almost 20 years ago that people have started this experiment. They have expanded size-selected clusters in a flow tube and then have shoot on these clusters with well-tuned lasers, and they could measure basically in this form the heat capacity of such a cluster as a function of temperature this cluster has when it enters into the flow tube. And what they find are these kind of curves. These are heat capacity curves. This looks at first instance like a second order transition. You have a maximum here. This maximum has been interpreted as the melting temperature for this finite system. And you also can associate to this melting temperature a latent heat, either by the change inside the internal energy curves, as it is shown here, or by the integration of these heat capacity curves. So these are experimental data that have been performed now on a range of clusters, not only sodium clusters, but also aluminium clusters and others. And we were particularly interested in sodium because sodium is particularly simple. If you look at the experimental ionization potential of sodium, you see these very much altering in the ionization potential, which has been since ever interpreted as that sodium clusters are clusters with low multiplicities. So either all the electrons in these clusters are paired, or if there is an odd number of electrons, these only one electron is single, and then the ionization potential is dropping because it's easier to get out these electrons. Another well-known phenomenon of sodium clusters is that if you look in a cluster beam and you look at the counts of clusters, then you see characteristic maxima in these counts. Notice that these maxima numbers here are for the cationic clusters, yeah? So the number of electrons in this cluster is one number less. So instead of 9, it's 8 electrons. Instead of 22, it's 20 electrons because it is a cation. And this has been interpreted since ever that these clusters are particularly stable and they have a kind of, closed shell part of electronic configuration. So there is this gallium model of these clusters as an analog to the electron model of the atoms, where you assume that each sodium atom donates one electron into a molecular electron gas. And now if you count these electrons, you can have something like these shell closing, 1s2, 1p6. So this would be 8 electrons. So you have closing of the s and the p shell. That is the sodium 9 plus you just saw as a prominent peak in the mass spectrum of such kind of sodium clusters. And these kind of capital S here and capital P denotes quantum numbers now of such kind of cluster orbitals. You see here for sodium 4, these are Cohn-Sham orbitals. You see here the double occupied S orbital. Now, this would be the S2 configuration. Sodium 4 would be equivalent to 4 electrons. And you see here the double occupation of a p orbital. And this closing here, that you have a closed shell system, that is different to an atom. If you would look at the carbon atom, which has also 4 valence electrons, if you look in the periodic table, then you know the ground state is a triplet. And that is because you have degeneracy of the p orbitals. In a cluster, these degeneracy of p orbitals can be avoided by Jantella distortions, and it has been really common knowledge since ever that these Jantella distortions will take place in such sodium clusters. So this is the introduction to the work we want to do. Here's a small validation of the accuracy of the methodology that we are using inside these Born-Oppenheimer molecular dynamics. Important for us is that we are energetically here in terms of dissociation energy. We are playing in the right ballpark. The errors are in the range of 1 to 2 kilocalories per mole, which is very acceptable and important for what we want to do. So this is what was the experimental questioning here. The questioning was, if you see here, this is basically a melting temperature versus a cluster size. However, the cluster size increases here from right to left. Here is sodium 55 plus, and this is its melting temperature. And here are larger sodium clusters, and their melting temperature is much smaller than that one from sodium 55 plus. In fact, the melting temperature of sodium 55 plus is in the same range of the melting temperatures of clusters with thousands or more sodium atoms. So the question was simply why? Why has sodium 55 plus such a particularly high melting temperature, which is somewhere around 300 Kelvin? There have been three different experiments. These experiments are really tedious, and they have been, because this is such an outstanding situation, three different experiments that confirm the melting temperature is somewhere around 300 K and the latent heat in the range of 19 kcal per mole. So why is this so? And the general idea is that here in the sodium 55 plus, or the, I would say, hypothesis, really, that inside the sodium 55 plus, there should be a specific mechanism, because if you put 55 atoms together, particularly metal atom, you can have these icosahedral kind of shell. And so the idea was that this is really a geometrical issue, that this is a geometrical reasoning why you have such a large melting temperature. And that is definitively supported by the fact that sodium 55 plus is not an electronic shell closer. The shell closing would be at sodium 59 plus. So if we go along with this concept of shells that I have just explained you on the slide before, sodium 55 plus should not be a particularly stable cluster, but it is a cluster that has a particular high melting temperature. Why is this so? Concept is geometrical shells closing, and also fact is this is only strictly valid for the sodium 55 plus. This is a setup for such a Born-Oppenheimer molecular dynamics. And here is the computational demand. So this is now really a demanding calculation, because you are making molecular dynamics simulations that hold several nanoseconds. So if you have 200 picoseconds trajectory length, 20 trajectories, you have 4 nanosecond sampling time. That's a typical sampling time, actually, not even for semi-empirical methods, but for empirical force field methods. And these calculations take something like 2 to 3 months on 128 cores. Yeah? So this is a demanding calculation. And these are the results you get out of such a Born-Oppenheimer molecular dynamic simulation. So this is not experiment. This is completely first principle simulation results. Here you see the heat capacity as a function of temperature. And if you look at this, what was experimentally was somehow 290, 300. We are seeing 280 K melting temperature. This is an excellent result here also by structural changes. We have a latent heat of 20.5 kcal per mole, which is within 1 kcal per mole agreement to the experimental estimated latent heat. So what this shows you here is that we can obtain quantitative agreement. And that is important, that this is not a qualitative agreement. This is quantitative agreement between first principle Born-Oppenheimer molecular dynamics results and experiment. So that is the good news. And I would like to show you now how does these sodium clusters look like at these trajectories. This on the left-hand side is the sodium cluster before melting. This on the right-hand side is the sodium cluster after melting. Remember that the speculation was that the high melting temperature occurs because the sodium cluster before melting is in an icosahedral shape. Well, our molecular dynamics does not show that, obviously. And now there are two possibilities. Either our molecular dynamics is wrong, which is bad news for the people who have worked on that, or the idea of the icosahedral structure of the sodium 55 plus is not really correct. We saw this effect quantitatively in this prolate deformation coefficients, and when we showed actually this graph the first time to the experimentalist, so that was Bernd von Isendorf from Karlsruhe, he immediately said, we believe you. We believe you that something here is not right. So what we found out of our molecular dynamics, despite the fact that the melting temperature is in excellent agreement or in very good agreement with this experiment and also the latent heat, that sodium 55 plus is fluctional below the melting temperature. So it's not a frozen structure, it's a dynamic structure before it really melts. And it is definitely not icosahedral, what we saw just in these trajectories. Now, that worried us a lot for quite a time, because this is in fact contradictory to the photoelectron spectra interpretation, because you see here in sodium 55 plus, this bend is very narrow. It's much narrower than in 54. And it was sort of that this narrowness of this bend is an indication for its geometrical icosahedral structure. So again, there is a possibility, because the photoelectron spectra and the melting experiment are not done in the same apparatus, that in fact the structure is different when the photoelectron spectra is recorded and when the melting is done. Not a very satisfying explanation. Definitively, our results of the trajectory are contradictory to geometrically shell closing. Honestly speaking, after this result, I don't believe in geometrical shell closing at all. So that was very frustrating, actually, and it basically told us that the results we have are not publishable, which is not such a good news. So we went back to the very first fundamental ideas of cluster science for sodium clusters. And fortunately, we were looking at sodium clusters. In these clusters, if you look at the orbitals, the Cohn-Sham orbitals, which are the equivalent to the cluster orbitals, you really have a textbook analog to the gellium model. Now you see here S shell, P shell, D shell, another S, another P. Here you see an F shell. Here you see an F shell. Here you see the other P. Here you see a G shell. Here you see another D. And these was the orbital occupations we have used in all of our calculations. And all other people have used that in the literature, not only for sodium 55 plus, but for all kinds of sodium clusters, because of the spectrum of the ionization potentials I have shown you at the beginning. We know that a sodium cluster with an even number of electrons should be a closed shell cluster, so should have no unpaired electrons. However, if you look closer in these calculations, you see that this gap is very small. And you could imagine a high spin, paramagnetic sodium 55 plus. It's at least imaginable if you look at this small gap that you have set. So this would be a quintet from the multiplicity. And if you look at the relative energies, now these are static calculations, simply optimizations of sodium 55 plus done with PBE, and then it was shooted with everything that was in the literature. It comes out that in fact sodium 55 plus, at least at these levels of theory we have looked at, and that is LDA, GGA, hybrids, meta-GGAs, the ground state is a magnetic quintet spin state. There is no doubt on this. And that also explains to a large extent what has been seen in the photoelectron spectra. Because in the photoelectron spectra, this band here was assigned to the 1G, but it was not said how the 1G was occupied. So in the singlet, the 1G is occupied by four electrons that are paired. This picture is this. And you see that there is a quite rather large splitting between these two parts. And in fact, there is a sodium 55 minus photoelectron spectra where such double occupation would be expected in the G band. And there you see a splitting that looks extremely similar to what we have here. On the other hand, if we look in our new optimized quintet structure, sodium 55 plus, what we see here is in fact such a small shoulder that is also shown in the photoelectron spectrum. So this convinced experimentalists and many other theoreticians that in fact sodium 55 plus is an high spin structure despite all the common knowledge about other sodium clusters, and it has triggered calculations from other groups. This is a calculation from Vince Ortiz with a real ab initio method that is a third order propagation calculations that can be used for vertical electron detachment energies, and they find qualitatively exactly the same what we find in our DOS picture for the quintet state. So they confirmed that these photoelectron spectra must arise from a quintet state. And so what does this have for an effect on the melting of the cluster? So we had to do the Born-Oppenheimer molecular dynamics once again, now not for the singlet, but for the quintet. And here are the curves of these two heat capacities. Red one is the singlet curve and blue one is the quintet curve. You see that in the melting temperature, basically nothing has changed. Also in the in this figure, it looks a little bit as if there is a change, but in the latent heat, there is no change by more than a kilocalorie per mole. That is absolutely within the accuracy of the methodology. However, there is a dramatic change in the molecular dynamics simulation now in the trajectory. What you see here is on the left-hand side, you see the singlet sodium 55 plus before melting temperatures at 250K. On the right-hand side, you see the quintet sodium 55 plus also at 250K. Both, this is the start of the simulation. Both simulations have started with the nearly ideal icosahedral structure. And what you see now is that on the left-hand side, the singlet, so where all the electrons are paired, so the antiferromagnetic state, if you want to say so, after a very short time, the icosahedral structure pattern dissolves. And in fact, it never comes back, as it was shown in the previous movies. On the right-hand side, however, the icosahedral structure pattern remains, and it remains and remains and remains for a very long time. After 100 or 200 picoseconds, these steps here are femtoseconds. So after 100 or 200,000 steps, this icosahedral structure in the quintet somehow disturbs, then it stays for maybe 1 or 2 picoseconds in a disturbed structure, and then it collapses again into this icosahedral structural pattern you see here. So the answer to the experimental question is, it is not an extra icosahedral structure. It is a dynamical icosahedral structure pattern, which is the reason for the high melting temperature of sodium 55+. So with this, I finish again here, put this back. Oops, and I think we make a small break now for questions again. What do you think? Hello?
Everybody can make questions, can post questions in the chat box.
Okay, tell me simply the question and so I can answer. The best is simply raise an arm. You can ask in Spanish, please. My Spanish is good enough to understand, and I might even be able to answer some of them in Spanish.
Can I have permission to make a question?
And everybody has permission to make a question. I'm happy when some questions are coming. I'm very disappointed if no questions are coming.
All right, we have one question from Jimena. Please go ahead, Jimena.
Okay, please. Also,
I was wrong.
Okay, I was wrong. That means I don't have a question.
Yeah, I don't have a question.
Okay, so. Sí, pero si tú tienes una pregunta en español, por favor, pregúntale.
Professor, regarding the sodium cluster, the charge is important for this kind of cluster, right?
Yes, absolutely. There have been simulations in the literature that have been done with neutral clusters, and they claim to have obtained the same. Hold on for a moment, because I have a noise here. I go briefly outside to stop this,
Jimena, ¿tienes pregunta? Volviste a levantar la mano.
No tengo pregunta, creo que se está
picando. Okay, sorry for this disruption. Sorry, I only finished the first question and then we come to the next. Coming back to this, yes, there have been studies in the literature that on neutral clusters, and they were claiming to obtain similar results. Well, it turned out that the results are a little bit different, particularly the trajectories look for neutral clusters completely different as the ones I have shown you. Okay.
Okay, we got another question.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure who raised the.
Then we start to talk, and then we look at this.
We got a question in the chat box. In the calculations of first principles for electrons, how can we verify the calculations with the real measures?
Okay, good. The verification of not only first principle calculations, but on any kind of calculations, always has to be done by experiment. And for this verification, it is absolutely mandatory that the experiment and the theory really calculate the same thing. So for example, in the case of the sodium clusters, these were experiments on isolated individual clusters that were melted in the vacuum. So for this reason, there is a direct comparison possible between experiment and theory. If you have a melting process, for example, in a solid or in a liquid, then the situation is much more complicated, because in the calculation, you would have to take into account the solid or liquid in its full form. And that means much, much larger systems. But I mean, the big strength of first principle methodologies is that you can show at specific examples that you quantitatively match this experiment. This has been done for example, bond energies and bond structures since long ago. For molecular dynamic simulations, honestly speaking, there are almost no such comparisons. Also, these comparisons I showed you with the sodium 55 plus is one of the very few comparisons where you have a quantitative match between theory and experiment under conditions where you really quantitatively can match this. There are similar calculations for aluminium in the literature, also by other groups, and they show the same. Okay? I can see the chat, so you can ask questions in the chat, also not in Spanish if you want. Okay. Okay. Is it possible to calculate the effect of the van der Waals interactions inside these sodium clusters? It is possible, absolutely. It has not been done in these simulations. So possible it is, because there are empirical and I think now also one or two non-empirical formulations for van der Waals interactions. The formulations are still cumbersome in the framework of density functional theory. And that you always see when you compare these kind of Cohn-Sham calculations or ADFT calculations with corresponding coupled cluster calculations. They are not perfect. So in these particular calculations for the sodium clusters, we avoided that because we wanted really a first principle approach. We did not want any kind of empirical addition or corrections on top of that. That is why we don't have done this. But yes, you can do this, and this is not very expensive. This is very simple to do. Ah, okay, copper clusters. Okay, wait a moment, I'm on copper clusters here. Okay, I have to see this copper clusters. Okay, that is great, great, great. Moment, 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 not so fast. One question after that. Okay, I'm coming to the copper cluster from Jans. Yeah, that is, yeah, super question. We have been asked by theoreticians since the last 5 or 6 years to do the same simulation on copper clusters. It is possible. Also now one can do these simulations on copper clusters. The program and the computational development is now at the part that we can do this. We haven't done this, I must admit, because there is no experiment on copper clusters. And the reason for that is that the apparatus, there are only 3 apparatus in the world where you can do this, these experiments. They can't melt copper. What they can, however, do is aluminium. We have a new implementation of molecular dynamics where we can go to larger aluminium clusters, and we found there something that is beautiful, because we have something that is, contradictory to what is an experiment, and we believe that we are right, experiment is wrong, but we need to make more calculations there. But yeah, you can do it with aluminium, and in principle, you can also do it with copper, at least from the theory side. Yeah, I agree, it's possible. Okay, what is with REACT-FF? Well, I have a slide of REACT-FF. It's a catastrophe, to tell it simply. So you would really to reparametrize force fields in order to get these kind of results. Okay, next question is, what kind of model should be used for crystallinic structure? Is it possible at all? Yes, crystallinic structure is possible in principle. In fact, this has also been mentioned yesterday by Aldo. There is a program out there, it's called Crystal, that uses technology that is, let's say, at least similar to the one we are using in Demon 2K in this ADFT. They don't use really ADFT. And with this program, you can do crystal structures with LC-GTO. I think that's the fairest thing I can say. If you do this, you have, of course, the benefit to be able to use hybrid functionals. You have the benefit to have localized orbitals, but the program is much, much slower than, for example, WASP as a representative of plane wave programs. So that is the situation for crystalline structures. With Demon 2K, we do not have periodicity inside the program. We have another technique, but I would not recommend it for crystal structures. I will talk about that a little bit on Friday for QMM. Okay, next question. Are all the BOMD calculations always of high computational cost? Yes, they are expensive. If you want to have accurate results, the calculations are unfortunately quite expensive. Okay.
Hi, I have a question.
Yeah, go ahead.
Okay, thanks. Professor, I think that was a beautiful example of the of how we can use ab initio simulations in the sodium 55 cluster, uh-huh. and they identified that was a quintet and not mm-hmm. a singlet.
Yeah.
I have 2 questions. How do you know when the cluster is melted? And because in the movie we saw I saw that the clusters were only moving around some positions. And how did you know that that was melted?
No, you
that
do
was my
not,
first question.
You do not. I mean, you do not identify meltings based on the trajectories on the movies. You are taking the data of the trajectory, and then you make what is called a multiple histogram method to calculate the heat capacity curves. And from the heat capacity curve, you then obtain the melting temperature. So you do not really look at a pictorial melting of the cluster. Also, if you go to very high temperatures, you have here to think about that even so our trajectories are a few nanoseconds long, this is still a very short trajectory. So at the melting temperature, the cluster will not show a melting behavior at 4 nanoseconds or so. The melting will happen at much longer time scales. But if you go to higher temperatures, let's say something like 700 or 800 Kelvin, then you will see that during the trajectories, you do have for example, fragmentation pattern of clusters. But this is a completely different story, and we are not so sure that what we are doing and what we are seeing there is really right. Even so, there are experiments on selected fragmentation channels, not for sodium clusters, but for copper clusters. The question was here from the group in Mainz. And one could look if one can match these kind of collision-induced dissociation experiments with such molecular dynamic simulations. That is something we haven't really done, but it is thinkable to do this.
Okay, thanks. And my second question is, which structure did you begin the molecular dynamics simulations?
With a nearly icosahedral structure. In the case of the singlet, it's nearly icosahedral. In the case of the quintet, it's perfect icosahedral. So it started always icosahedral.
Okay, thank you very much.
You're welcome. Okay, here's another question I see. That is from Daniel. In which point do you consider the temperature in the electronic solution for the evolution of the cluster? Okay, good question. We do not. The electronic calculations in Born-Oppenheimer molecular dynamics are always done instantaneously at 0K. The temperature in these simulations come into the calculation by the movement of the nuclei. The electronic structure solution is always a 0K solution. Now, there are methodologies where you can incorporate temperature into the electronic solutions, but these temperatures, for at least sodium clusters, must be very, very high, also much higher than the melting temperature. The incorporation of temperature into solution, for example, for transition metal cluster, not copper. Copper is a very special transition metal cluster. That is not an issue. But if you take something like iron or cobalt, there, these electronic temperature might play an important role. But what it really simulates is not so obvious for me, because you have a multi-determinant, so multi-state solution there, and the temperature basically smears over the different states. So if you would talk with somebody from real ab initio quantum chemistry, that person would not, advertise temperature in the electronic structure solution. Yeah, exactly. What you understood is correct. The electronic solution always is 0 Kelvin. Okay, next question. I have a really basic question. Oh, that are most often the most difficult one. Okay, I can't get a full definition of what a cluster is. Could you help me to understand that concept? Okay, that is a complicated question, actually, because from a very naive point of view, you could say a cluster in first instance is a molecule. And yeah, that is true. It's a finite system. But the word cluster has been introduced for molecules that are chemically not stable. But hold on, then you come to what is C60? C60 is a fullerene cluster, and the word is used, fullerene cluster, and C60 is rock stable. So in reality, I think that the words molecules and cluster are used, at least to the best of my knowledge, interchangeable in the literature. And the word cluster is most often used in the community where people look at size-selected clusters or molecules in ultra-high vacuum. These people never talk about molecules. They always talk about clusters. Okay, well, maybe it's not so satisfying, but that's the best I know. And the other question, it's, I assume that the graphics that you show are the results of the output file. Yes. What software do you use to visualize them? Well, we use usually Molden. The movies I showed you were not Molden movies, but we use usually Molden to visualize these kind of trajectories and of also optimizations also. And that goes rather easy and rather fast. Okay.
We got a question from Diego.
Okay, adelante.
Hi, doctor. Good morning. I have a question here.
Yeah. Sorry, I hardly can hear you. Can you maybe try to speak a little bit louder to the micro?
Yes. Is it more audible?
Wait a moment. Something I don't hear. Let me put my... Can you speak?
Yes.
Okay, louder, more loud.
More louder?
Yeah, more loud. Shout.
Like that?
Yeah, like that is good. Shout, shout. Okay. No problem.
Okay, thanks. My question was in the sense of the stability of the system.
Yeah.
The last system of the sodium 55.
Yeah.
So it had to do with the multiplicity of the cluster, I understand.
Yes.
So the effect of this multiplicity is, can we say it can be as strong as geometric stabilization or a shell completeness like you thought at the principle, at the beginning?
That is, also I don't think that the effect is as strong as shell completeness. That I don't think, because you don't see these particular clusters, for example, in a mass spectrometer. They don't show particular stability. They are, however, we call this subshell closing. These subshell closings, they are stabilizing high symmetric structures. In the sodium case, the difficulty was that there is not really a structure. It is actually a fluxional molecule from the very first beginning on, even before it is melted. But there are other systems. We have a paper in, I think, in JAX or so, where we looked at other systems where these subshell closings also occur, and they are stabilizing their high symmetric structures. So they do have a stabilization effect, but it is not as large as for a shell closing.
Okay.
Okay.
Yeah.
Okay. Let's make a small break of a few minutes, let's say 5 minutes, so that 12:15 we are coming back, because I have to go here to tell the guys to stop the screwing. Okay.
Okay, thanks, Professor.
Okay, see you in 3 minutes.